Hello and welcome to What in the World. This is a regular show where enterprise Googlers talk about an interesting topic for maps of business. My name's Dylan Thomas, I'm a maps community manager, and joining me today is Avnish Bhatnagar, who's a technical solutions engineer. Hi Avnish.
Hi Dylan, it's a pleasure to be here today.
Thanks. So you're an expert on Google Earth Enterprise, and today you want to show us a bit about what's coming up in the 5.0 release.
That's right, we have a lot of exciting new features. We've listened to our customers about many of the feature requests that they've asked for over the years, and we're really pleased to announce that we have implemented many of them.
So I think today you were going to talk about the new publishing workflow. You're going to talk about alpha masking and WMS, but I think first you wanted to just say a few words about how this release fits into the broader picture of the product plan, right?
That's right. Google Earth Enterprise is an important component of the overall ground-to-cloud strategy at Google, wherein you could take layers that may exist in Google Earth Enterprise online or offline in Google Earth Enterprise. You could cut those globes that you have in those two platforms and serve them all together in a single unified way.
Got it. So we're sort of removing the boundary between the products in some sense by letting you take data from Maps Engine and serve it with Earth Enterprise, or take data from Maps Engine and serve it with another product entirely, like the portable.
Exactly. Right? Through the portable server, that's sort of the common denominator that bridges Google Earth Enterprise and Maps Engine.
All right, well, thanks for sort of setting the scene there. So I guess why don't we take a look at some demos now? I think you were going to start with the new publishing workflow.
Yeah. So I have here my Fusion machine that I've logged into. So as before, I just go ahead and launch Fusion. And this may look familiar, not too many changes on the front end of Fusion. And these are some databases, both 2D and 3D, that I've already built here in Fusion. So if I start with the 3D one, for example, this blue marble database, a very simple blue marble database with a few vector layers.
Yeah.
If I right click on this, you'll note that the option for push is there, but not publish.
Got it.
And the reason is we've decoupled Fusion and server. Mm-hmm. Publishing now is a server side function. And that goes a long way in simplifying the overall workflow, wherein before you had to, on your server, create what's called these virtual servers.
Yeah.
A virtual server was like essentially one part Apache virtual server and one part the publisher mapping that existed in Google Earth Enterprise.
Yeah.
And to be honest, it's somewhat complicated to properly create that virtual server with the Apache directives, configure it. And so that's vastly simplified now.
Got it.
All you need to know now in Fusion is build your database and push it to your server.
Perfect. So it's just way simpler, one concept instead of a couple.
Exactly. So I've already built my database, so I'm going to go ahead and push it. When you say push, I have one server association that's built out of the box called public. Mm-hmm. And I select the version of the database I want to push. And I say push. It gives me the database successfully pushed. So now what I'm going to do is go to my server. And this is something that's new in that there is now an actual user interface, a web-based UI for the server. If I just type in the URL of my server, I'm presented with a splash page that confirms the version I have. And at the top right is a button that says admin. I click on that. And typically, I'd be presented with a username and password, which in this case has been saved. But the idea is that only administrators should have access to this admin page. So this admin page, number one, functions as a dashboard. Uh-huh. It tells me right off the bat how many databases do I have, how many of them are published, what my disk storage is like, what the cutter status is. So in one unified view, I can get a snapshot of my server.
So in a 4.x environment, let's say the current environment, how do you get this information right now?
Well, since there was no single UI in 4.4, you had to get this information through the command line.
Got it. Okay.
Various command lines, and you would have to extract that from different.
So you can at 5.0, you can still do that. We're not taking that away. You can still get that information in that way if you've got scripts that pull from it or what have you.
Exactly.
But this just gives you a much easier option to get everything in one shot.
Right. It really, I think, facilitates management of your server. Under settings, I can also look at I have direct links to my documentation, which is bundled with the product. So it's not reaching out to Google to get the documentation. Yeah. It's in the product itself. I have a link to my Apache logs. Oftentimes, when something goes wrong, the first place you want to look is in the logs. Mm-hmm. So now we have a direct link to the access log and error log. And I can launch my cutter from here. In other words, if I want to cut my 2D or 3D globe, I can launch that as well directly from the UI. But let's now go to databases.
Right, because we're trying to publish, right? We're trying to finish the second part of that process you started.
Exactly. So you might recall I published my Blue Marble database. Sorry, I pushed it from Fusion to my server. So it's showing up right here. There's an entry for Blue Marble version 15, and it shows that the status is currently unpublished. So all I have to do is select it, click on Publish, and here is where I select a publish point. This is what we used to call in the past virtual servers, where this part of the publish point is what defines how users are going to connect to your
The endpoint access they would use in their client to connect to the server.
Right. So I could call it something simple like demo. I tell it what search tabs I want in this database. And note that I can mix and match what types of search tabs I want. It's all specified right here in this single box. Snippets also is something that I no longer add in Fusion, but I put in right here when I'm publishing. And the advantage of that is I can have different snippet profiles for different publish points. So that way, if I had a secure globe and I only wanted certain logos to appear on that secure globe, certain search tabs, I can define that here, whereas if I wanted a public globe that has the same underlying data but with different search tabs and different snippets, I can manage all that right here. By default, there's only one virtual host, which is public. If I wanted to create a new one like secure, I could do that and add in all my LDAP or authentication credentials. And here's where I select whether I want WMS enabled on this globe or not. So I say
yes. We're going to get to that in a minute, though.
Exactly. All right. And then I click on publish. Done.
Great.
At this point, my endpoint is ready. My globe is ready to be served. If I click on that again, I can even preview it right here within the browser. It's going to open up my, basically the, as you can see here in the URL is basically that of my GE server / demo. And in this case, it's trying to load it in the plugin. As the plugin loads, I can also directly connect from EC, the enterprise client, which I'll launch here.
So the publishing process is pretty much instantaneous.
Exactly. Because it's essentially just a mount point.
Yep.
And there's my globe.
Great.
In EC.
So again, just to reiterate on the sort of this new publishing workflow, there's the separation of concerns, if you like, just doing what's appropriate at which stage. We're not taking away functionality with command line driven workflows that you may already have, but we're just giving you a really easy new way to accomplish this in a UI.
Exactly. We're just decoupling the publishing function, moving all publishing functions to the server, which is really where they belong.
Yeah. Great. Thanks. So why don't we move on and look at the next two items? The first was alpha masking, and I think we're going to revisit the WMS item as well.
Okay. So alpha masking is a feature that folks have asked for quite some time, and the use case is this, that let's say I have some really high resolution imagery over Mountain View, California. The rest of my imagery, though, is not so high resolution, and in fact, I want to get that from some other place, some other database. So I can now build my imagery project to just have the high resolution imagery for Mountain View.
Okay.
In the past, we've asked that you have a base layer with worldwide coverage.
Yep.
That's no longer necessary. We've removed that restriction. So as an example, let's go back to my Fusion interface here. And if I pull up my imagery project, I have an imagery project here that consisted of just Cuba. And I chose Cuba just because it's a island with some interesting features along the coastline. So I had some high resolution imagery of just Cuba.
Yeah.
And I included that in a database, which I've already published. If I go back here to my server UI, I have this Blue Marble version 13 database, which is published at mountpoint/cuba.
Got it.
And I can see that's already published. It tells me when I published it and the size. So if I go now to EC and I connect to my server/cuba, you can see here that the entire globe is blank except for Cuba.
Mm-hmm.
So this is my high resolution imagery just for that region. So now I want to overlay this essentially on a base of lower resolution imagery.
Okay.
From another database, from some other source. Now that could be Google through kh.google.com if you have a license of Google Earth Pro, or it could be another Google Earth Enterprise database. So I'm simply going to say add database, and I happen to have another internal GEE server running, which I'm going to connect to pull in imagery for the rest of the world. And there you go. So if I zoom into Cuba now, there's my imagery for Cuba overlaid on top of the imagery of the world.
Nice. And you can see them both.
Right. Now, the order does matter. In this case, the imagery of my secondary database is being overlaid on top of my imagery of Cuba.
Okay.
So usually I'd want to switch that, right? So typically then I would connect to that, the imagery of Cuba, that database, I would connect to that second.
Got it.
So I can simply say disconnect. I'd probably want to first connect to my database that has worldwide coverage, and then add the database that has the imagery of Cuba. And there you go.
Yeah. So the alpha masking is really, it's a pretty straightforward feature in terms of the end user experience. It just makes a lot of sense. It's how you want to see it, but that's something that hasn't been possible at all until
exactly.
This new release. Great.
Right. And this is a feature which, if you decide you want in 5.0, you would need to rebuild your imagery resource.
Got it.
And that's a
great point. Yeah, because I think one of the things customers are asking at this point is about the need to rebuild databases, the need to make changes to their core assets. And you're saying this is one of those new features that would require
right.
that.
The okay. bottom line is you only have to rebuild your resources and projects if you want to get some of these new features.
Yes. Yeah. Okay. Well, let's round it out then with a closer look at the WMS feature.
Okay, yeah, that's a really exciting feature that folks have asked for, especially users of various OpenGIS tools.
Yeah.
I can make a 2D or 3D map accessible through WMS. And all that involves is enabling any one of these globes, 2D or 3D, I'll start with 2D, say this one right here. I've already published this, but I just want to enable WMS on this. And let me make sure I'm serving the latest version here. 10.17, yep, that's today. Okay, so it's already published. Serve WMS. And it says actually that target path is already in use. So maybe I should choose a new one like Demo2D. If I wanted to add search tabs to this database, I could too, right here.
But your point here though is that it's very, very simple. Even if you've got it serving already, you can just go back and add that capability. It's very
exactly.
simple. Okay.
It's all dynamically, you know, the publish points are dynamically created.
Yeah.
It doesn't involve restarting the server anytime you make a change or anything like that.
So I know you can do 3D globes also, but why don't we take a look at the what the client experience here? I think you have an example of
right.
looking what this feels like.
Yeah, so this is a preview of my very simple 2D natural earth map here. And it doesn't have very many layers, some urban areas, country borders, and that's about it. So now let's confirm that it's being served via WMS. Mm-hmm. So you typically want to launch whatever your preferred OpenGIS WMS client might be. In this case, I'm going to launch QGIS. And over here, I say add a WMS layer. And you specify your WMS server here. Make sure the endpoint's correct. The one I created was demo2d. Type that in, /WMS. If it has a username or password, you got to enter that mm-hmm. there too. And then I say connect. So now it's essentially done a get capabilities request on my WMS server and seeing, oh, I have three layers available, imagery, urban areas, and country borders. So now I can add the desired layers into my QGIS workspace. I'm going to add country borders. And urban areas, and then my imagery. And if you want to reshuffle, I guess, the rendering order, you can just move any of those up.
So just like the alpha masking, I mean, this looks pretty straightforward stuff, and in fact it is, but being new in 5.0 is a pretty major feature and a major new capability that customers, as you said, have been asking for a very long time.
Exactly.
So this is a pretty exciting one for us. And this is WMS 1.3 and I believe 1.1 also.
Correct.
Okay.
Yeah, we support up to WMS 1.3. And as I zoom in, you can start to see the layers.
Cool.
It might be necessary to disable some of those. Let's see. Depending on what's being rendered on top. And you can see down here in the lower left the actual WMS request mm-hmm. that's being made.
Great. Well, let me wrap up with one quick question for you then. You're in the geo support team, so you're the one who gets all the tough questions at the end of the day. Is there anything about the 5.0 release that you think is going to be difficult for customers or might trip them up at all?
Not too much that I would anticipate. One feature we have implemented is sort of gravitated towards Mercator map projections.
Okay.
So for 2D maps, mm-hmm. we support Mercator only now.
Got it. Okay.
And that involves rebuilding your imagery projects.
Okay. But I think this is something that we've announced to our Earth Enterprise customers for some time now, right? This should hopefully not a surprise to anyone.
That's correct.
But it's just something, another one of those
something to be aware
of, right? Okay.
Right.
And I think you've worked on the integration guide or the upgrade guide, I should say.
Right.
This new version.
In the upgrade guide, and there will be some white papers on possible solutions that if you do have a flat database mm-hmm. on migration strategies, how to continue to serve that flat database as Mercator, et cetera.
Great.
So we'll offer solutions along those lines.
That's good to know. Well, Avnish, thanks so much for taking the time to talk with us today about 5.0 release.
You're welcome.
We'll see you next time on What in the World. Thank you.